Hello, everyone. Very warm welcome to another live Action for Happiness event. It's so lovely to see hundreds of you joining us from all around the world, as always. And I'm so excited about our special guest today, Louie Schwartzberg, who is a very inspiring man, and I can't wait for this conversation, but also a wonderful filmmaker. And I'm so grateful, and we're all so grateful to you, Louie, to allow us, many in this community, to have seen this amazing film you've made. Louie, welcome, and thank you for being with us. And actually, you're muted, so maybe you could unmute so we can hear you. But welcome, and thank you for being with us.
Okay. Well, it's a joy to be here with you, Mark. I love the fact you have this, you know, community built on happiness. And I love looking at all the great wisdom you have on your website. It's really cool.
Well, I'm really excited to be exploring the theme of gratitude. It's very much at the heart of what we're doing with Action for Happiness. But you have made an incredible film about it. And if those of you joining us at this live event haven't had the chance to see Louie's Gratitude Revealed film yet, there is a special chance to see that as part of your involvement in this webinar. So we'll be sending out more details if you haven't already seen that. But Louie, I wonder, could we start, because you have obviously a filmmaker of great renown and have made a wonderful series of films, which I've enjoyed. And I wondered if you could maybe take us through a little bit of the backstory as to what's brought you to gratitude and why this topic is so important to you.
Well, I think it probably started growing up in Brooklyn. Parents who were Holocaust survivors, you know, certainly taught me to be appreciating all the little things in life. You know, for them, it was a roof over their head, food on the table, a steady job, the miracle of having children. They appreciated all the little things because after what they went through, it was heaven on earth for them. And I think that also was a foundation for taking a perspective to everything I do when I film nature. You know, appreciating all the little guys that make the world go around, the bees and the microbes and the fungi, and wanting to be a protector for all of life. You know, anything that celebrates life and nurtures life, I'm for. Anything that wants to extinguish life, I'll be vigilantly resistant.
Tell us about the gratitude theme, Louie, and the journey to this latest film.
I think I got the question now. Well, look, sometimes people do wonder, they go, why did you make a film about gratitude after you made a film about mushrooms like Fantastic Fungi? And I think the answer to that is, for me, fungi is just a portal into nature's intelligence, into the, you know, the wisdom and the mystery that surrounds us. And I wanted to be able to take that wisdom that we discovered under the ground, a mycelial network, a shared economy without greed that enables, you know, ecosystems to flourish, take that intelligence and bring it above the ground and find ways that we can, you know, integrate that into our lives. It's, you know, it's one thing to be turned on by nature's wisdom, but then you have to ask yourself, what are you going to do about it? How are you going to manifest or activate that beautiful natural intelligence? And that's what Gratitude Revealed enabled me to be on the journey more into the soul, to be able to take that wisdom from below and bring it above. It was natural. And also during the pandemic, we've all become so disconnected from each other, not being able to have, you know, dinner with friends and family. The politics are like totally, you know, in the gutter. Everybody's hearing about environmental degradation. It's only natural that there's a despair and a certain amount of mental wellness crisis that people are talking about. And so, you know, having gratitude is like this little baby step you can take that slows all that down. It isn't the silver bullet, and it's not like the antidote for this giant thing we're dealing with here. But what it is a little tiny baby step that enables you to stop the negative spiraling rumination, to be able to think of one little thing you're grateful for, that you can move your fingers, that you're breathing, that there's gorgeous clouds drifting over your head, that you're alive, that there's a trillion cells in your body that are working in harmony and you don't have to manage it. I mean, there's so many things you could be grateful for, and that literally does stop negative thinking, because you can't have a negative thought and a positive thought at the same time. So I use it all the time as an ace in the hole. Every time I get down, every time I feel rejected, anytime I feel like a victim, you know, we're all human, And I pull it out of my back pocket and I go, what can I be grateful for? It's a little exercise. Can I do it right now? And I know I can find one thing to be grateful for, like this lemon water that I'm drinking. I'm going to savor it and enjoy it as we talk.
Well, I likewise, and it's become something I was a little bit skeptical about years ago, and it's become a life-changing thing for me. And why don't we do this with the community right now, Louie? Because as you say, even in difficult times, there are always things we can find to be grateful for. I have just had a frustrating experience with my Wi-Fi going down in an event that I've been looking forward to all week. And yet I'm grateful for the fact that we can still do this. And I'm hoping that you can at least get some of what I'm saying, despite these challenges. Why don't we take a pause for everyone who's here right now and just bring to mind something that you're feeling grateful for right now, wherever you are in the world, whatever's going on for you today, even if things are tough. Look around you, tune into what you're feeling, and let's just share in the chat some of the things that we're feeling grateful for. And I can read some of these out, Louie, but I'm seeing sun, my dogs, listening to the birds sing, flowers, my team at work, a mug of tea, my family, health, the smell of spring, daffodils, food, my husband, my friend, my job, my watching this webinar, sport, kids, autumn leaves, action for happiness, meditation, waterfalls, eyesight, children, and many, many more. How are you feeling as you see that list fly past, Louie?
I had to take a picture of it. I think it's great. It gives me so much joy to know that there are so many other people that are, you know, on the same, you know, journey that we're on, you know, thinking positive, wanting to make the world a better place, celebrating life. And it isn't just like, you know, a small minority. I think it's a movement, and I think you guys are crushing it and making it a big movement. And that's what lifts my heart. I want to know that there's a ton of us out there that are, you know, open-minded and compassionate and want to celebrate life. That to me would be like the greatest gift in the world.
Well, thank you for saying that. And that's certainly the feeling I get with this community, that there is this collective energy of wanting to look for what's good, not to turn away from the challenges in the world, but to respond in a grateful and constructive way to what's going on. Louie, for anyone who's not seen some of your fantastic filmmaking yet, I know you've got a couple of little clips that you might be able to share with us. Maybe we could have a look at some of this beauty in nature. And I wonder if, as you introduce that, you said something to me which I found really inspiring about trying to make the invisible visible. Maybe you could say a bit about what you mean by that before you share the clip.
Sure. Well, you know, I do a lot of like time lapse, slow mo, micro, macro, and it's because I want to be able to show you what other living creatures see and feel. And rather than talk about it, I can literally show it to you. So, you know, we can speed up time and slow down time. We can see what the energy of a flower opening and closing, 500-year-old redwood tree would look at us like little time-lapse ants. And on the other hand, we're moving in slow motion to a hummingbird. You know, and so, or to a mosquito, everything has its own metabolic rate. Everything has its own frame rate. And when I can manipulate the frame rate, then you get to see things that the human eye can't see. And that opens your heart. It gives you a broader world perspective. It gives you compassion, and it makes you want to, you know, protect all living things. So I think I'm going to show, here's just a little short one. Let me see if I can get this to work correctly.
So I'm going to. You're a filmmaker. We have full faith in you, Louie. We're sure.
Yeah, I know.
It was so lovely seeing that list of gratitude. I'm still reading it now. Isn't that incredible? Seeing the map,
great.
People are sharing. Okay.
Hold on. Let me see here. Can you see my screen now?
I can see the screen, but I'm not seeing. I saw the list of films.
Do you see the flower?
Yeah.
Do you see the flower? No.
I'm not seeing the flower. I'm just seeing the blank screen.
It stops here. I'm going to try it again.
Folks watching, I'm sorry about the combination of technical challenges
about now
we're having. That's perfect. There we go.
Here we go. So This is with, you know, Lindsay Sterling. She's an amazing musical artist, plays electric violin. I think she's got like, I don't know, 200 million views on the song.
Wow, that really is breathtaking stuff, Louie. It's amazing how you capture, and it makes me feel a real sense of kind of awe, I think is the right word, sort of like a sense of there's this majesty and something so powerfully beautiful about the natural world that you often, I think, especially in urban life that I'm in at the moment, it's quite easy to feel disconnected from. How did you feel emotionally filming some of that stuff? Because your films move me to tears, actually, on a couple of occasions. Yeah. Really powerful.
Well, thank you. Well, I feel moved. I mean, imagine laying in that field of, hundreds of thousands of poppies, and the poppies are all saying, I need to make love with a pollinator, you know, because I have this little short window. I'm gorgeous. I'm orange. I'm luscious. Come get me. I can feel that, you know, and it's like, that's the energy that I want to really transmit, and the fact that you can see them in their time frame, they're dancing to the light. You know, each one is like a ballet move, and you have to ask you the question, like, why is it beautiful? It is like just jittery. I mean, it's elegant. It's like perfect. It's like, you know, it's beauty. And then I always do that deep dive, Mark, into like, which I think is really a spiritual journey. Like, if you ask yourself the question every day, what is beauty? You know, why is it turning you on? Why does it create a certain emotion? And I'm always asking that question because I don't think there's a solid answer for it. You know,
but I think maybe one of the answers, and I've heard you express this before, which is that when something's beautiful, we want to nourish and protect it. That's the feeling we have
exactly.
towards children. That's the feeling we have towards things that are precious, generally, things yeah. that are cute, things that are beautiful. It's a form of nurturing and protection that I think is so powerful. And actually, I think what your films and your work is doing is reminding us of this world that we want to protect. But one of the things I wanted to ask you about was, we talk about having a sort of deficit-based or asset-based approach for looking at life. Some people are looking at what's wrong, and of course that's really important to know what's wrong, but also
right.
I think what your work does is help us focus on what's right in order that we cherish it and nourish it more in the natural world. I mean, do you see this kind of beautiful film work, for example, as a way of encouraging us to be more pro-environmental, pro-social, pro-nurturing, if you like?
Yeah, I think the basic premise is like self-care equals world care, you know? And so first you have to get peaceful inside. I think looking at, you know, the rhythms and patterns of nature, especially through a prism where I either slow it down or speed it up or zoom in or zoom out to make it, you know, to go beyond the surface of it, you know, to get into the mystery of it, that reawakens, I think, every cell in your body. I think it reawakens all your neurological pathways, because you're basically at that point looking into a mirror of nature's energy, you know, because the patterns and rhythms of the tree or the cell or the Milky Way are all similar, and they all have the same dynamics and the same physics. So I want to look at something that's like pure energy, that's healthy, that's positive, and that's why I'm bringing it into healthcare and using it in situations with oncology or alcohol addiction, to be able to use it as a healing modality. I truly believe that it can, you know, make you feel better.
And it's one of those virtuous circles, as you say, self-care is world planet care, or, you know, we care more for the world around us. But I guess what we also know, those of us working in the sort of field of mental well-being, is that being in nature is enormously good for, you know, helping us cope better with challenging situations.
Right.
You know that when people are in green space, when they're outdoors, when they're physically active, that it really support, you know, it's an antidepressant. It's a kind of natural boost. So it works both ways, which I find really beautiful. But I also, you know, here we are in a world where it feels, as you mentioned a bit earlier, that there's more and more division and toxicity and people kind of at odds with each other. And there's something about what you're presenting here, which is reminding us of what we have in common. Maybe we could speak about that a bit, the fact that we are all part of this same amazing ecosystem.
Thank you. With Gratitude Revealed, the beautiful thing is I filmed, you know, remarkable but ordinary people, basically extraordinary people that are not famous, you know, everything from like a dairy farmer to a rug weaver in Appalachia, you know, a jazz musician in New Orleans, red states, blue states, conservative, liberal. We all are just another version of each other. And when you learn that, then I think it bridges, you know, that separation that politics uses to create the other, you know, separation from other groups and separation from nature is our problem, you know? And when you, with Fantastic Fungi, I think I scientifically proved that it's all connected when you look at the mycelial network under the ground. That's pure science, that the trees are a community. It's not an individual tree. We are also interconnected. Pandemic showed that in kind of a glaring light, you know? I guess the message in a way is I'm showing that we are literally all connected, and therefore maybe we have to become more conscious that, you know, what we do to others, we do to ourselves.
It's interesting you mentioning the pandemic, because of course we're still, you know, it feels as though the world has moved on, thank goodness in many ways, but of course there's still a huge sort of psychological and physiological lasting impact of that. There are obviously people who've been still dealing with major health challenges and have lost and trauma. But there's also, you know, the fact that we disconnected from the natural world for a bit. We locked ourselves away. We disconnected from each other. And actually, I wonder if one of the upsides, I mean, I feel that one of the upsides is that we are now talking about mental health more than we were. I actually think we also rediscovered, how much it's not good for us to be locked in our houses, and actually how much we need to be connected with the natural world. Did you see that as well?
Absolutely. No, absolutely. And you know, the stuff that I do, if you want to call it digital imagery, is not a substitute for going outside. I want to be really clear about that. I mean, if you can go outside, be on a walk, forest bathe, that's really great. But there, for a lot of people, they're never going to go to Galapagos. They're never going to go underwater with a whale. They're never going to go to like Machu Picchu for a lot of reasons. I mean, if everybody did go, you'd destroy those environments. But the truth is a lot of people don't have the money, the time, the resources, the health to travel to these exotic locations, which, by the way, are disappearing due to environmental degradation. So if I can share that with people digitally, these sacred places that are truly, you know, gifts on the planet, wow. That, I think, is, an alternate way of experiencing the power of beauty. I mean, imagine if I said to you, only listen to music. The only music that you should really listen to is live music. How limited would your palate be? You would never have heard the Beatles. You never would have heard Jimi Hendrix, right? I mean, so to the human brain, sound wave energy, light wave energy, it's just light wave energy. You know, I don't think it's judgmental about whether I'm hearing it live or whether it's being recorded, you know, because in a way it's just really observing pure energy, pure wavelength energy, I think pretty much without judgment, right?
Yeah, I agree with that. Actually, I hadn't really thought of that before. I mean, obviously there's some things about being out in nature where you get the natural light and some other things that are good for your, you know, circadian systems and so on. But actually I felt watching your movies like a real visceral connection to nature, even though it's on a screen, which is, so it's something about our eyes recognize the natural world in a way. So I think that's really powerful. Louie, you talked about how you met people from across a range of different sort of lifestyles, backgrounds, political situations, whatever. You're brilliant at telling inspiring human stories. Is there any one particular one that stands out for anyone who's not seen the film, or something you'd love to share as a nice story?
Well, two of my favorites, I think, one is Eric Weimeyer, who is blind, who had the determination to climb Mount Everest, and he does. That is just really remarkable. And then, so he's a little bit, recognized, but then I ran into this woman, Minnie Ansley. She's no longer here, rug weaver in Kentucky. So she actually found me. I'm at a gas station. I'm about to do a story about coal miners. I'm looking at this whole thing called a map. And she says, well, you look a little lost. You're not from these parts. And then I said, well, no, I'm a filmmaker. You're going to do the story about coal miners. And she goes, well, what's your name? I said, Louie Schwartzberg. And she goes, well, if I were you, I'd say your name should be McCoy or McClintock before you go in those hills. And she just had this like glint in her eye. And I thought she was like, I asked her what she did. She said, she's a rug weaver. And I shot that story with her in a half a day, weaving as she looks outside the window and talks about work ethic and values between her husband on the tractor and her at the loom. It's such a powerful moment in the movie. It's such a sweet, incredible thing. And again, it's Appalachia, earth mama. It's not an elitist, new agey person. It's a mountain woman who lives off the land. And so she's one of my favorites too.
Mm. Well, what we're going to do is include either in the chat live or in the follow-up email tomorrow, a reminder of the link where anyone who's not seen Gratitude Reveal can do that. And a bit later on, we'll talk about how you might be able to share it with others, maybe host your own screening and so on. But Louie, on the subject of, stories and individual stories, this is obviously something that's touched your life a lot. And here we are, the subject for today's event is gratitude and nature. I wondered, could you share a couple of the things that you do as a personal practice around gratitude and your own connection to the natural world? How does it become part of your daily life?
Yeah, so one thing I discovered as a practice, which at first I thought is also an obsession and maybe OCD, but I've had cameras going nonstop for 4 decades, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, doing time-lapse, shooting time-lapse flowers. So what that is, so the first thing in the morning I do, what I want to do is I want to go down to my little time-lapse studio room and see, did they open it or did they didn't open? Did they die? Are they in frame? Are they out of frame? And hopefully I've scored a good shot and I'm joyful. But what it is, it's also kind of a juggling act, because if one thing fails more than succeeds, I quickly set up another shot. The most valuable asset is time, and the most difficult thing about time lapse is it takes a lot of time, so you can't have a gap between effort A and effort B. It's constant that as soon as one thing dies or nails it, boom, on to the next. So I've squeezed 40 years of filmmaking into about 20 hours of film with two cameras rolling side by side, where I'm capturing roughly, let's say, 2 seconds of screen time per day.
Wow.
So I think it's a nutty practice.
It's a labor of love, isn't it, really?
Yeah. But for now, it's almost like in sports, most continuous at-bats, or games played. It's like I have this too. I don't, even when I'm traveling, I don't want to break it. If I'm going to be gone for a week or two, I'll shoot a cactus, that grows slowly. I just keep on doing it,
Louie, one of the things I notice when I go out and about and I have teenage daughters is that a lot of people are living their lives through what they're capturing on their smartphone. If it's not on Instagram, it didn't happen. Or, you're at the gig and everyone's holding their phone up. I mean, do you have to force yourself as a filmmaker to sometimes let go of the camera lens and just be there, you in nature without that?
That's a struggle. The truth is, yes, I want to feel it and I want to be able to imbue that in the shot. But at the same time, the other deep desire is I want to share it. And that overcomes the hassle of having to think functionally and be very conscious and make sure I don't screw up and have every setting right, for the f-stop and the focus and the aperture and the recording and the memory card and all that stuff. you know, that is digital that I have to actually relearn every year. I can't just even rely on the fact that I have gray hair and I've been doing this a long time. I have to learn every year new digital technology. It's just so the desire to share is the thing that pushes me. It's like, wow, look at that incredible sky. You know, it's like, and we all have that feeling, right? We all want to share. Like, if hopefully people like the film Gratitude Revealed, they'll say, hey, I want to share that with my friends. You know,
I think that's often why we're holding our phones up to take a picture. It's like, this is for fun, and I want to connect. And this is a beautiful link between, I think, the natural world and our connectedness, our common humanity. So why don't we talk a little bit about how people can share Gratitude Revealed? You and your team have very generously made this film available. It was the International Day of Happiness 2 days ago. We did a big global push to promote the film. Thousands of people have watched it. I think you're also keen that people might try and arrange local screenings. Do you want to say a bit about why you love people watching things together in a community?
Yeah, absolutely. So we actually created like an educational curriculum. We have a teacher's, you know, handout and a parent handout. So you can like watch the film with your family, have a conversation at home. What we're offering is virtual screenings. People can go to gratituderevealed.com. And whether they want to have a screening in a theater, a church, you know, with a group, we can, you know, provide all of that. We want people to come together. We want people to see each other. And the other way we're also doing it, we're having some really big live events where I'm really excited, where we combine watching, you know, the film with, you know, spoken word poetry, live music, like, you know, Rob Garza from Thievery Corporation is going to play at our New York event in middle of June. I want to throw a party, you know? I mean, why talk about happiness? Why not just do it, right? Mm. I mean, if we're going to celebrate gratitude, let's celebrate. I mean, you know, get the wisdom from these little golden nuggets that I've captured over the years. But at the same time, let's move our bodies to music and dance and see each other and feel that sense of community. So I want to experiment and kind of create these hybrid immersive experiences.
Mm. I love it, Louie. And again, we'll send more details about that education.
Oh, I'm sorry. And then Mark, but one other thing. So people are going to be able to, part that I sort of left out is all this virtual community collaborations will also happen on what I just created, the Louie channel, which is louiechannel.tv, which is the first over-the-top streaming platform. I think that any individual is created that's not a giant conglomerate. You know, I'm not like Netflix, I'm not HBO Max, I'm not Major League Baseball, but we need a place to go that celebrates life. And I got friends of Louie that are putting up their content as well. Howard Hall, most famous underwater cinematographer, and others. I want to create a platform where we don't have to worry about getting negative energy put into our brains.
And it's both that passion that you bring, but also generosity. I'm getting a real sense of wanting to share, wanting to inspire, wanting to change. And I think it's that sort of cultural change that we need. So I, you know, lots of us want to get away from a sort of toxic negativity in our culture, but it's not about ignoring what's wrong. It's about also noticing all the beautiful things in the world and trying to prioritize those more. We talk about wanting to be a realistic optimist, seeing life as it is, and then choosing to put your attention on the good bits. So how do you see that? Because of course, you know, even in nature, nature's not always beautiful. Nature can do some pretty cruel, difficult things in terms of earthquakes and, you know, life-threatening challenges. You know, how do you see that balance between the darker side and the optimism?
Well, I think you can have an optimist and you can have a pessimist, you know, and they both agree on the facts. You know, the way I look at it is the optimist is going to roll his sleeves up and try to do something.
Yeah.
You know, for example, if you're in a rowboat and we're taking on watermark, we're about 100 yards from shore, and we have a pessimist and an optimist next to us, and the pessimist says, we're fucked, we're going to drown. And then the optimist says, I think we can make it. You know, let's go for it. You know, I want to swim with the optimist.
yeah, absolutely.
And I think we're going to make it.
Yeah.
I mean, your worldview shapes your reality. Gandhi said it too, right? Be the change you want to be, you know? And we have to be careful, especially with media, not to get sucked into the, you know, the news cycle and all that social stuff. Because when you're there, if it has your attention, it has your consciousness. And this community understands what I'm saying totally. You know, it's now you're in their world, their little sphere, their little thing. And that's control. That's powerful control. We need to be able to, and it's also the currency of the day. How many views you have, how many followers you have, that's worth more than money, okay? Mm-hmm. That's why Fox did all this lying. They didn't want to lose their audience. They actually lied about an election that almost, you know, killed our democracy. It's pretty amazing, you know? A handful of journalists can do that, quote-unquote journalists. So I'm not getting political. I'm just saying about how we could easily be warped, you know, psychologically by grabbing your attention. And it's easy to grab your attention when you show a train wreck, when you talk about fear, when you talk about disaster, you talked about the dark side. You know, I don't want to go into the dark side. I'm going to choose to go into the light.
But it's interesting because I find my attention being really drawn to your cinematography. It's like, wow, this is epic. It's like really, it's sort of breathtaking and much more grabbing of my attention than a lot of the stuff that seems to be in our news. So, you know, all power to you and getting more of that into the world. But in a moment, I want to come to the question. So please, folks, if you have a question for Louie, please use the Q&A function. You can also vote on each other's questions. So the most popular ones will come to the top. So we'll come there in a second. But I'd love us to also do a quick, another interactive thing with the audience. And, you know, I found this really inspiring. It makes me want to do more to connect with nature and to bring a sense of optimism and to get out there and sort of nurture the natural world and encourage more people to do that. What are you feeling motivated? Wherever you are in the world, what are you feeling optimistic about and motivated to do based on what we've been talking about here, about the beauty of nature, about the there's so much to be grateful for? Let me just share a few thoughts in the chat about some of the things that you're wanting to bring into the world in terms of optimism and action and positivity. So I'm just going to read a few out again.
Yeah.
Hunting mushrooms in nature, go for a hike, go bouldering outdoors, do some weed clearing, be a kind interaction, plant a garden, growing my own food, learning how to read trees, cycling in the woods, searching for sea glass on the beach, spring photos of sprouting in the forest, wild camping, breathing the air, gardening, walking by the sea, breakfast in the garden, wandering, nature walks, teaching organic practices, slow swimming, going to the park, calming my mind, listening to the birds, watching the sunrise. Wow, I'm feeling really moved seeing this list. And I'm seeing that you're doing your natural filmmaker thing and filming.
I just wanted to capture all those great words. I mean, that was like, you know, sacred wisdom being shared. I mean, you know, like that's everything that I'm trying to do. If you're going to ask me a question, I go, that's the answer. Whatever the question we're going to ask me, that's the answer. All of that. And I love the fact that it does exist outside of me. You know what I mean? That like this wisdom, its consciousness is everywhere. It's not like in my brain and I'm emanating out. This consciousness is like radio waves. We're all like little antennas because everybody is saying what we all believe to be true. And what we all want to encourage in each other. That's really beautiful.
It really is beautiful. And on the subject of beautiful, do you have any, did you want to share another one of your short clips from the film?
Sure. Before? Yeah, that would be great.
And then we'll come to questions. But I know people enjoyed that first one so much. So
okay.
I'm not going to fight with any more tech challenges. But
it should be okay.
What's the next one you wanted to share with us?
This one's about pollination. And I think, you know, before I hit play, I want to make sure that it'll work. Hold on here.
Whatever you did last time was good.
Yep. I think you see it, right?
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, so this is about pollination. And before I hit play, pollination, you know, I made a film called Wings of Life. You can see it on Disney Plus. Meryl Streep is the voice of the flowers, seducing bees, bats, hummingbirds, and butterflies to come pollinate. And, you know, for me, you know, science calls it a keystone event. It's the intersection between the animal world and the plant world that enables life to happen on this planet. Because without the flowers, we wouldn't get the nuts, the seeds, the fruits, the vegetables that enabled mammals to evolve. So it's a big deal biologically or scientifically. Obviously, it's really gorgeous because basically it's seduction. And I love the fact that the bees are being seduced, you know, by the flowers in sensual beauty. We talked about what is beauty, color, taste, touch, smell, you know, come get me because I need to get fertilized because I have a short biological window, you know, and I need to reproduce. And perhaps reproduction is the strongest force in nature, right? Because plants, animals will do anything desperately to make sure that their seed goes forward, which is also evolution. These are big ideas, right, Mark? Amazing. Okay, so
okay, thank
here
you.
So here is this magic window, because I love keystone events. I love being at the fulcrum point between the animal kingdom and the plant kingdom. And the last thing I'm going to say is, this is a symbiotic relationship, but think about this. It's being done unknowingly. It's not a quid pro quo. It's not, I'll scratch your back, you scratch my back. The bees are doing this to get nectar to feed their babies, you know? The flowers are doing this to seduce the bee to be a messenger for its DNA in order to reproduce. I don't assume that they know they're doing it for each other, okay? But because they are, we are the beneficiaries of all of that cool magic.
Oh, thank you, Louie. I'm so moved to see that. And I'm seeing people in the chat saying they're moved to tears there as well.
Yeah. Look, we got some people that are moved to tears.
Yeah.
And, so I was just for a moment, like, why ask the question? Why tears?
Why?
It wasn't sad, you know? And I think when you have tears, it means that it touched your soul.
Yeah.
You know, that it's been a long time since I've been home. It's like a homecoming, that feeling. Sometimes I tear up if I've been traveling. I go to my bed, or you go to your hometown. That feeling of reconnection sometimes makes you cry.
Yeah, I think I only really experience it like that with music that touches the soul and natural imagery that touches the soul. I was struck watching that we have so many modern movies that have incredible CGI,
yeah,
and none of the CGI is anything like as beautiful as the real natural world. It's incredible that we, well, thank you for reminding us of that. Let's come to these questions then. So I'm going to look at some of the most upvoted questions.
I love it. I love all these tears.
Harry's asked, does your research show if there's a particular type of nature or natural environment that helps support anxiety or is sort of more beneficial in sort of experiencing gratitude, for example, sea or trees or flowers, or is it just all of nature has that potential?
I think all of it. I think it's different strokes for different folks. You know, people, for example, like in healthcare, I came up with the idea at Jacobs Medical Center, brand new hospital. They had like an iPad next to the bed, which is this thing called patient experience. We want to know the procedures that are happening to our bodies. We don't trust doctors 100% anymore, which is good. So anyways, they have an iPad, they have smart TV. And I said, let's give patients the power of choice when choice has been taken away. So we're in a world you want to go to be healed. And the choices are ocean, desert, forest, flowers, different ecosystems. So I think people will, you know, select different areas where their power spot would be. So I think it's all good. And what I'm excited about, Mark, is doing these clinical trials where I'm trying to collect data so that someday it could be Dr. Schwartzberg will be prescriptive and I'll be able to say, Mark, you know what you really need? You got to be looking at more slow motion ocean wave crashes, you know? And I think what your wife needs to look at is more like, you know, time-lapse flowers.
Yeah, it's making me think now. We've got this app with this amazing community sharing ideas every day. Wouldn't it be lovely to have a few nature clips built into things like that, where if you might, you know, we have things where someone could do a meditation or someone can do an activity, but it's like, just watch a bit of nature for like 2 minutes. And that's just a kind of restorative action.
Yeah.
I love that. Laura Ann has said, how would you advise people to start to spread gratitude and kindness among their peers and family and friends?
Say thank you. I mean, yeah, that's the ultimate thing. And just, you know, being present and listening with people and, you know, telling people that you appreciate what they're doing. And it's amazing how that spreads. And it's really easy to do. And I think it's easy to forget to just simply do that. I mean, thank you is gratitude in the moment. And I think gratitude is that feeling in your heart that you can hold on to after that, you know, feeling of generosity or compassion?
I find it sometimes the people that we owe the most debt of gratitude to, our nearest and dearest, our loved ones, our friends, that we almost risk taking for granted. And of course, you know, we want to tell the people we love how much we love and value them while we're still all alive together. Not taking for granted. Vic has asked a really difficult question, but an important one. And it's basically making the point that some people, for very understandable reasons, find gratitude really hard. So in Vic's case, says, I lost my sister when I was 18, killed in a car accident. Vic, I'm so sorry to hear that. I found it hard to be grateful ever since. You know, I have everything I ever wanted in my life, yet I struggle to feel gratitude on a daily basis. I feel like I can never let myself be happy. And that's obviously a really complex set of emotional things. And I really feel for Vic and others in that situation. But what would you say to help us unlock a bit of gratitude when we are struggling to find it?
Well, in his particular case, it's really interesting. Just 2 days ago, I was at the Shepherd Hospital in Atlanta, which is like the premier hospital in the world for people that have spinal injury. So basically, it's really the state of the art of therapy. And so there are all these people that are learning to adapt that they can have a great life, you know, learning how to, you know, function in a wheelchair, if that's what it is, and being able to, you know, they had a kitchen that's designed easily to maintain. You can have a great life. And then there was a big board where people that are going through this process would write little quotes of inspiration. And it was all optimistic and life affirming, you know, that you can have a great life. You know, it was just really beautiful to be there. So, you know, when circumstances happen, it's terrible, you know, and it happens, I think, to all of us. But I think being resilient is really, you know, one of the elements of gratitude. And, you know, finding the ultimate, you know, like in this particular case, you know, therapy place so that you can get back on track and have a positive attitude. You know, the biology of belief, I think, went into all of that. I mean, if you, faith, whatever faith is, you know, placebo effect, 20% benefit in any clinical study, whatever you believe in is important, and you need to believe. Because otherwise, the cells, the trillion cells in your body aren't going to be working in harmony or flying in formation.
I'm really glad you mentioned therapy there, Lou, because one of the things that I think is a really wise thing I've heard Brené Brown and others say, which is that when we numb, we can't selectively numb our emotions. So when we try and push away the darkness and the pain, we also push away the gratitude and the joy and so on. And it's only actually sometimes when we can open space for the difficult feelings as well, we're then more emotionally re-engaged to connect with the joy and the beauty as well. So sometimes in order to re-find that, that sort of optimistic way forward, we sometimes do need to lean into how what's really going on in difficult situations a bit first. And that comes on nicely to this question from CK, who says, Louis, as you've chosen to focus more on gratitude, do you find that you're experiencing things like, you know, the darkness and negative energy less and less? Like, do you find that your ability to repel some of the difficult, bad things happens more quickly?
The answer is yes. As soon as I get that negative feeling, at least you have to be conscious that, you know, it's happening. And yeah, so I observe it. I got it. But I don't want to ruminate about it, which is like going in circles over and over in your head. So that's when I flip myself into what can I be positive? It's a challenge. It's great. It's kind of fun. It's a puzzle, whatever. It's a game. What can I be positive for? And I start doing that. And it's almost like the hard drive on your computer. If you max out that hard drive with good stuff, there's literally no space for the bad stuff to enter. You've only got so much hard drive in your brain, you know? So the more you fill it up with good stuff, the less room there is for the negative stuff.
Yeah, my poor mum fell over yesterday and bashed her head and cut herself quite badly. And I called her up and on the video phone to her, and she was just like full of optimism about the fact that her niece was there and she, you know, it could have been worse and that she was fine. And it was just like a really lovely example of someone choosing to see what's good rather than what's wrong. It could have been a very different conversation. And that's partly because she has chosen to take that approach to things. And I think what you've said is the more we cultivate this, the more that it's part of our repertoire. It doesn't mean things are always going to go well or that there aren't, isn't going to be dark stuff, but it means we're right. also going to notice what's good. Jude said, thank you for your beautiful films, Louie. Just wondering what you feel the relationship is between awe and gratitude when we connect with nature.
Ah, that's a good question. Okay, so awe makes you feel like small in the universe, which like they stand at the edge of the Grand Canyon, you know, under a redwood tree. And that is awe, you know, when you realize you're just a small particle in this giant universe. And when you feel that, then you feel connected with everything. You lose your fear of dying, which is really powerful. And then all of a sudden, you're grateful that you have the ability to be touched in that way, you know, to have that emotion, to have that feeling of, to have a spiritual experience, whatever you want to call it, a transformational experience. And I don't have to define what that is. I don't have to put a name on it. Like, was it God or was it divine or was it a hallucination? I felt it. I felt moved, right? Which we're all talking about here. And hopefully what the imagery does is you want to move people. If I feel moved, then I'm grateful. In order to be moved, I have to be awed.
Yeah, and I think awe, for me, it connects you with this sort of sense of majesty and makes you feel really small, but also kind of part of something bigger. And I love what I love about, well, certainly your Fantastic Fungi work, and also as you revealed, is that sense of interconnectedness. And although at one level we're a tiny part of it, it also makes you feel part of something huge, which right. is both, yeah, it's kind of a weird combination of micro and macro altogether. And actually remembering the Fantastic Fungi film just for a moment, a couple of people have been asking about your mushroom necklace. Is that right? Is that what's the story behind it? Is. What's around your neck?
It is a mushroom necklace, which is, I'm just wearing it as a lucky memento because it was given to me at the Telluride Mushroom Festival, which I go to every year. It's really a great festival for someone who was just grateful for the movie. And then I wore it because we were distributing the film, and knock on wood, it took off because we self-distributed, which was very risky. So I'm superstitious and I haven't taken it off since.
Love it. Louie, this question from Stuart's a bit of a techie one. And I, at one level, I was thinking, well, maybe it's not so relevant. But actually, I think it really is because of what you've said about capturing moments and wanting to share them. It really is a powerful way of connecting and spreading this. So he's just said, hi, Louie, do you have any tips for capturing great photos of the natural world with low budget equipment? How do we yeah. get a little micro version of what you're doing?
Yeah. It's not about the equipment. It's about the intention and the commitment, you know, to, you know, wait for the perfect moment for the butterfly, you know, to land on a flower. Try it. It's very difficult. Try it like all the pollinator montage you saw. Credit that to hours and hours and hours and days and weeks of filming, you know, to get that magic moment. So it's commitment, it's time, it's energy. That means anybody can do it in a way. And now with the iPhone, I'm bowled over, you know, that it is so potentially affordable for anybody. I'm not saying I would use an iPhone, but I'm blown away that anybody can use an iPhone and get great stuff. I haven't done it yet, you know, but I'm amazed. So it's time, you know, that, and I think that's true in any profession or career, you know, that one wants to be really a master of. It is, there's no secret book or software. It takes a lifetime to become a great farmer. It takes a lifetime, you know, to be a counselor. It takes a lifetime.
But to your point on intention, which I love, if your intention is to capture a beautiful image that's going to win a photography yeah. prize, that's one way of thinking. But actually what I've loved on our app community, when people are often sharing what they're doing that day, is the pictures of the natural world that move me aren't necessarily the ones that are beautiful or in the right lighting. They're the ones that are really natural and authentic and real. It's like, oh, here's like a funny reflection I saw in a puddle when I was walking along. Right. Here's a leaf that looks a bit like a heart. Here's like my dog by a tree, you know, and that's they're not beautiful photos in the conventional sense, but they're beautiful because they're really personal and really natural. And I think there's something to that, isn't there?
I think, look, I love that you mentioned, you know, weird stuff, because there's beauty everywhere, graffiti, a fire hydrant, whatever it might be. I think what we're saying is we are recognizing a universal truth that lives in the rhythms and patterns of the universe, the man-made world, and or the, you know, the natural world, which is really one and the same anyways. And when we see that truth, what's really cool is that it isn't just a truth for you. The fact that everyone's, you know, loving the film and you're responding to photography that somebody else did, it touched their soul, it's touching your soul, which means we have a shared, let's say, opinion at least of like what is beautiful or what it's like moves your soul. But it's deeper than that. The fact that we can both be on the same vibration.
Yeah.
And we're trying not to get cosmic here. That's what's really cool. Yeah. That we go, yeah, that turns you on. It turns me on. And that means that it is a universal truth. It is special. What you captured there is really magically mysterious and wonderful. And not because I made it and convinced you to like it or vice versa. We both like it.
Yes, it's true. It's not like a fashion item that you like because someone's told you it's cool. It is inherently, intrinsically beautiful and you just feel it. Yeah, I so get that. Thank you for being so clear.
I'm sorry for being so anally descriptive. No. But that's really where I keep it. Like when you say beauty, just that's really being superficial.
Yeah.
Like then you have to say, what is beauty? Yeah. What is it really, what is happening in my body right now when I feel it? And then dissect it. That is incredible journey to be on. As a matter of fact, that's a practice.
Mm. Well, talking of practices, there's a question from Emma, which I'm not sure we're going to have time to do properly, but she asks about the connection between mindfulness and gratitude. And it reminds me that we've had this practice that we've been sharing with the world this week, which I think is a lovely way to wrap up a lot of what we've talked about today. It's called Mindful, Grateful, Kind. And it's a very simple thing that we in the Action for Happiness team have been practicing, and we've been sharing this week with the International Day of Happiness. I wonder maybe if we as a community could just do this briefly together now, and then I'll come back to you for some closing thoughts, Louie. But so be mindful. Just take a moment wherever you are in the world right now and just notice how you're feeling. Just tune inward for a moment. Touch the soul, as Louie said, and notice how you're feeling right now. That's the be mindful. And be grateful. You know, in the spirit of gratitude revealed, this beautiful film. Look around you, bring to mind what you've heard and seen in this event, the wonderful imagery, the ideas from each other in the chat, and just bring to mind something that you're feeling really grateful for, maybe just this chance to be together. And then the final part of this is keeping that sense of mindfulness, that sense of gratitude, is to bring to mind somewhere you want to send that to in the world right now, that sort of sense of love. Who are you sending love to? Is it to a particular person, a group of people, a particular part of the natural world? Where are you wanting to send love to right now? You know, there's lots of people in need of a bit of more compassion right now. So maybe just hold that people or that person or that natural world or those creatures in mind as you send that out into the world. And that's a very brief mindful, grateful, kind practice we've just all done together all around the world. And I think that it's emblematic of what you've been doing with this film, really, Louie, which is you've been helping us tune in to, you know, how we're feeling about nature, particularly recognize the beauty around us, but also you're encouraging the spirit of gratitude. So we're out of time, but would you like to leave us with any final thoughts about, you know, how we can bring this appreciation, this wonder out into the world around us?
Well, you know, it's funny because we're talking about gratitude and nature back and forth. I think that they inspire each other. So if you are grateful, you know, then you become present. And when you become present, you can really see nature. And, you know, and when you're in the moment and you see nature and you understand the harmony, the symbiotic relationships, all the beautiful energy of nature, how could you not be grateful? And then there I am, back to gratitude. I've come full circle.
Louie, I'm so inspired. Thank you so much for spending this time with us today. I want to thank everyone in this community for getting involved. Like you, I was really moved to see all the things people appreciate about the natural world, all the things they're wanting to do to nurture it. And it was lovely to share live with you and have you narrating for us some of that beautiful clips. Please do, folks, go and check out Gratitude Revealed. Will be a link in the follow-up email. We'll also send around the video of this conversation and the chat file with all the wonderful stuff that's been shared.
Yeah.
Louie,
thank you.
You're doing a wonderful service for the world. You're reminding us about the beauty of nature, and you're helping us appreciate nature and each other, I think, in a whole new way. So thank you for what you're doing.
Yeah. And Mark, I think the film will be on for an extra day, so people need, you know, have that opportunity.
Great. So that's a really generous chance for us to see
and
share this film for another day, free of charge, folks. So Louie, thank you to you and your team. It's been a real pleasure being with you today.
Okay. Nothing greater than sharing the gift of gratitude. Thank you, Mark.